I want to start with a definition. What is a smart grid? And I have used the definition that we can find from the European Commission. It's quite clear. A smart grid is an electric grid with the capability of integrating the, let me say, a lot of actors in order to ensure the economic operation of the system, trying to reduce the losses and in the same time have a high quality of the feed. This is the definition of a smart grid. What is the difference between a traditional grid and a smart grid? First of all, the main difference is that a smart grid is smart. And let me say, a traditional grid generally is a stupid grid, or a fixed grid, generally. The definition of smart is something close to the market, right? Okay, the difference. Generally, if we have a traditional grid, we can have a poor reliability, a lack of adequate communication infrastructures. Generally, we don't have any kind, or we cannot have any kind of communication infrastructure. Then we have to pay a lot of losses, joule losses. And what is very interesting for us, we have a lot of difficulty if you want to fully exploit renewable energy sources. This is a picture of a theoretical smart grid where we can see that we have a bulk production, another ring with the user. Some user can be passive user and the other user can be active user. For example, we can have a factory with storage or a factory with PV, or we can have just the storage and so on. So it's a grid where the actors are totally different from the actor. And what is very, very important, we can have the introduction of a lot of the storage system of a different kind with different characteristics. Here I say a smart grid is, but maybe it's more correct to say what we want or what we wish that a smart grid have to be. Efficient, accommodating, motivating, opportunistic, quality focused. To underline green. Another problem of a smart grid is that we need of a lot of interaction. So the communication problem are one of the most important points. These are the main actors, the markets, the operation, the service provider, the generation, transmission, distribution, and the customer. As you can see, the customer is very different from the customer that we can have in our mind, because he's a new kind of customer with the maybe wind or the PV, or wind and PV, why not? And why not wind, PV, and an electrical vehicle? This is the new kind of customer that we have to, we can have in the future. This is a challenge. Just to give you an idea of the complexity of the communication, in this picture you can see how many links we have from all the different. It's amazing, and it is really complicated. Okay? Of course, when we are trying, my company made a lot of very small smart grid in Africa, and they are small, so the communication problem are just a part, the one that you can see here. But from a theoretical point of view, any actor must to communicate to each other in order that the grid can be called smart. I have a lot of slides on this topic. You can download the slide, but I don't want to spend a lot of time on the description of smart grid. Anyway, if you have a question, I can focus the attention on something on that. And please interrupt me if you have a question. Because I want to focus the presentation on two or three points that, according to my opinion, are important from the technical point of view. So, for what concerns the description of each actor, I will be very quite fast. The market, in any way, is an important actor, as the operation. What is the operation? Is the control center of the grid. Is quite different from traditional operation system, and it is a very important actor of the grid. The service provider can be different in the future from the one that we see right now. It has to speak with the operation, with the customer, with the market in the same time. The bulk generation is quite simple to understand. It's the production. The transmission is another issue, because, for example, we often have a lot of problem for the transmission of the energy. And in the transmission system, right now, we can see that we are trying to include storage system based on batteries or ultra caps in order to try to stabilize the voltages and the frequency of the network. Same is for the distribution. At the end, we have another problem with the customer. Because in the past, the customer is just, for example, my house or my factory. Where is the customer? Okay. Now, instead, the customer is totally different. For example, in my house I have in the same time, okay, maybe my house is just a little bit different from the average of the houses. But I have wind, a small wind plant of, I have two small wind plants, to be honest. One of 1 kilowatt, another one of 2 kilowatt and a half. I have the storage system, I have the PV, of course, my house, I will test my product, so it's just a little bit different, but maybe it's not so different from the house of tomorrow. This means that the customer is very different from the idea that we had in the past. And I don't have an electrical car. And especially in Europe, we have to consider that, according to the opinion of a lot of actors, we will have a lot of electric car in the future. And this means that we will have a lot of problem because we want to charge the car. We want to charge very fast the car because we have two kind of problem. First of all, we need the energy to charge the car. Sometimes we want to charge the car very, very fast. See, this means that we need of power, not only of an energy. For example, in my house, I have not the right power to charge also a small utility electrical car because I have just 3 kilowatt. Okay, if I want to charge a car of 24 kilowatt, let me say, because I need of a fast charging on my car, is not possible. So I need to include storage in my house in order to charge the car. It's amazing. It's amazing. Okay. What are the characteristics of the next generation grid? Active demand. demand response, dynamic pricing. We have the problem of the plug-in electrical car. This is a big issue, or hybrid electrical vehicles, let me say. Interactive support of the grid, because the new challenge is not just to charge the vehicle, what we call grid to vehicle, but also the vehicle to grid. Because the idea is, if we have a lot of batteries that during the night, or also during the day, but mainly during the night, are connected to the grid, why not we cannot use that systems in order to return back energy to the grid? Why not? From mathematical point of view, it's very, very interesting. What means active demand? Share the energy with the grid. Practically, it's quite simple, right? This is the profile that we want. We can share energy from, shift the energy during the day. Okay, this is possible. We can use the battery that we have in our car for the grid to vehicle. Okay, grid to vehicle is quite simple. If I want to use an electrical car, I have to charge my car. But the question is it possible? And what are the costs if I want to return back the energy from my car to the grid? The first question, is it useful? And if it is useful, I don't know, I have my opinion, what are the costs? Interactive support, I will skip. Okay. This is a possible microgrid. We are working to this kind of microgrid, not to the smart grid as the one that I have shown to you. The example that I will show you are quite simple, all right? But they're in that direction. We have a coupling point with the distribution network and a lot of load or generator. We need to control the smart grid. In a way, it's quite classic. Power import and export to the grid. We have to control frequency and voltage of my grid. My grid, of course, have to work in island mode or in grid connect mode, if the grid exists, of course. Then I have to control the power quality and so on, as in a standard. Well, the first problem, have we to choose an AC or DC grid? Is it not a new question? At the end of 1980, we had what we call the war of the current. From Nikola Tesla, that maybe you know as the inventor of an induction machine, is not true. The inventor of induction machine is an Italian guy, the name is Galileo Ferraris. But anyway, this doesn't matter. And on the other side, we have Edison. Edison, with Edison, is the first utility in USA and try to sell energy in DC because they produce energy by using a DC generator, DC machine. Tesla with Westinghouse used the AC generator and the AC motor, the induction machine, induction motor, as you want to call. Of course, at the end, Tesla and Westinghouse won the war, but for one reason, because at that time the only technical solution to change the voltage is to use the transformer, and by using the transformer it's possible to increase the voltage and then reduce the losses, right? Now, we have different solutions. So we have a question. What is the best solution for a smart grid? A DC smart grid or an AC smart grid, okay? It's not a new question. What are the differences? Okay. The main difference is this one. If we have it in AC bus, we have DC AC converter. If we have a DC bus, we must use DC converters. That's all. By using now a DC converter, it's possible also to change the voltage because I can use a step up, step down converter and so on. By using the power electronics, now it's quite easy. Sometimes it is also convenient to use DC transformers. Some people call the boost converter as DC transformers. So it is possible. In all the examples that I will show you, you will find just AC bus smart grid. The reason is not a technical reason. The reason is a commercial reason. Because right now, if I want to buy DC-DC converters, I have to ask to the industry to produce a new product. This means cost, development time to market. If I want to build up this kind of smart grid, I have just to buy the right power electronics, write the right code, control code, and that's all. So these solutions are generally cheaper than this one, fast to use. This does not mean that it's better than this one. In smart grid that Electronica made in, let me say, in Eritrea, we have used this solution not because it's the best one, because it's a cheaper one. Now we can consider also this kind of solution. Just another example. Of course, we have also the problem of the control. We can use a centralized control or a distributed control to choose from this solution to this other one. Of course, the decision is also related to have high and communication system, have high, for example, GSM or internet of UMTS and so on. What is the cost of the communication system? If I don't have a communication infrastructure, maybe I will use a distributed control where in each node I have something, or let me say, or intelligent or smart. Advantage. If I have a DC transmission, I'm here inside the smart grid, right? I have no problem of reactive power, of course, I'm in DC. I can have a complete control of energy flow. It's not so true, because I can have the complete control of energy also in AC, but let me say it's quite simple to have the control of the energy flow if we are in DC. We can reduce the losses, okay? I don't have the problem of the synchronization. Yeah, DC. I can manage the inrush current. First of all, I don't have transformers, so I can have the problem of induction motor, but I will use the induction motor by using a controller or a front-end inverter, something that connect the motor to the grid through a DC link. I will show you. So I can have a lot of advantage, but I have the disadvantage of the cost. But not because the power electronics is more expensive. I have a factory, I produce power electronics. If you ask me a DC AC converter, okay? That is the website, choose the right one. If you ask me a DC-DC converter to change the voltage from 400 volt to 800, yeah, okay, it's possible, it's quite simple. Please write your requirements and wait for 3 months, 4 months, I will build up the right product for you. But you have to pay development cost and you have to wait. That's all. Now I will show you a couple of slides on the problem of the electrical vehicle, how to charge and discharge an electrical vehicle, just to try to show you how can be complex the optimization algorithm that is behind a charging system. Okay, this is the system that we have built up in my university. I'm the CEO of Enertronica. Enertronica is a spin-off company of the University of Cassino. And in my university we have this system. We have the grid, of course, the PV, the batteries. We have chosen a DC link connection. Then we have three or four, I don't remember, electrical vehicle. And we have developed a lot of control algorithm in order to find the right solution to manage energy flow. What we want to obtain, we want to use all the energy from the PV. If the energy produced by PV is greater than the energy that the vehicle needs, we will store the energy in the batteries. And at the end, if we don't have energy in the batteries, we don't have the PV, we must use the grid because we must charge the electrical vehicle. This is, in few words, the goal of the algorithm. From the mathematical point of view, it's not so simple. I have for you a very short description of the flowchart. What is one of the key points is to try. We don't have to develop a control algorithm which works. This is quite simple. What is important that the algorithm has the capability to find the cheapest way to charge the car. And we have to include one of the most complex problem that we have solved is to calculate the degradation cost of the battery. As you know, for any kind of battery that you are going to use, the life in terms of cycle of the battery will decrease according to a lot of factors, the temperature, the current, right? The quality of the power electronics, maybe. The key point is that as you discharge the battery in terms of DOD, deep power discharge, as the life of the batteries decreases, then you have a cost. At the end, this cost is a cost of the energy. You have to include also the efficiency of the conversion system, because if you put 1 kWh in the batteries, you cannot to return back 1 kWh. Of course, the efficiency is not equal to one. For example, this is the behavior, life PO, lithium, iron, phosphate battery. They can work up to 10,000 cycles. Now you can find also battery, for example, LTO batteries can work for 2,000 cycles. Okay, at the end we have to calculate the cost. Then we have solved a classical optimization problem with constraint. The constraints are quite simple, the system has to work. Okay, other constraints are the maximum current, the minimum voltage, and so on, and find the minimum price of energy. You can download also this paper, and not only the presentation, but also the paper where the algorithm is quite well described. Of course, I cannot to discuss about the algorithm here because we spend a couple of hours. But just to give you an idea, is a classical optimization problem. What are the key points are the allocation of the PV energy. We want to use the maximum energy from PV because we don't want to use batteries. If it's possible, we use batteries means that we have to pay the efficiency of the conversion system and the degradation cost of the battery. Then we can have a time shifting, so if we must obtain, use the grid, I hope that we can choose the right moment because the cost of energy from the grid is not the same during the day, right? And so on. At the end, we can consider also the grid, the vehicle to grid, so return back the energy to grid. We have a lot of priority. A point that is important to underline is that a lot of information are not deterministic but stochastic. So we can have an idea about the production of the energy from the PV, but we cannot be sure today for tomorrow, I mean, or this morning for this afternoon. We can have an idea about the cost of energy today for tomorrow, but we cannot be sure. So we have solved the problem by using a classical stochastic analysis, Monte Carlo, and so on. It worked quite well. And it is quite, let me say, just a little bit complicated. But it's not new for the engineers because it's just an optimization problem, okay? A couple of simulation and experimental results, but I suggest to you to read it if you want, of course, downloading the presentation. Okay. Just few words about all the possible solution that we can have in terms of storage. Hydro. Quite simple and well known. Compressed air can be used only for very big application and not for microgrid. Also the pumped hydro. Flywheels, these are quite interesting. There are right now a couple of companies that produce, let me say, quite small UPS based on flywheel. I don't like too much. No, to be honest, I like too much from in terms of engineering, in terms of research, but I'm not so confident that they will win the war of a storage system as the war of the current, right? The same for superconducting magnetic energy storage. They can be useful, but for very particular application. Then we have the supercap. Supercap are quite interesting. Ten years ago, a lot of the researchers in the world thought that they are very, very interesting in the future, but the cost of the super caps is quite high. And right now, I don't think that the cost will decrease so fast as lithium batteries. Energy density, standard batteries. Density 30-15 watt hour per kilogram per kilos. lithium 115, 200, let me say. The main problem in all the slides that I will show you about, for example, the project that we have made in Eritrea, we have used the lead acid batteries. One of the main problems of that battery is not just the cycles, it's the weight. Because it's really complicated to transport that kind of batteries. I will show you some picture and I suppose that are very, very interesting. Well, now, this is a possible application of any kind of storage system. As you can see, supercapacitors, power quality and the frequency regulation, maybe. Where you need a lot of power, but not a lot of energy. A lot of power for very small time. That means small energy. Application, grid voltage stability, power grid, renewable support. This point is quite interesting for us because one of the issues is okay, in a lot of countries we have a lot, we have the possibility that, for example, in Namibia, right, we have a lot of sun, it's an amazing country, right? But sometimes we don't have the grid, or the grid has not the capability to manage that energy. So a possible solution is to store the energy in the batteries and so on. But as in Namibia, also in Italy we have this problem. Yeah? But in Italy we have 17 gigawatt of wind and, no, just of PV, 17 gigawatt of just of PV, just to give you. Grid frequency solutions, customer energy management. Another problem is if we buy lead acid battery, it's quite simple to arrange or build up a battery pack. It's not the same if you want to buy lithium and so on, because we have the problem of battery management system. What's the problem? The problem is this one. If we charge and discharge that kind of batteries, at the end we can have this kind of situation that the energy in a single cell can be different from another one. How we can try to solve this problem? For example, moving the energy from one cell to another one, or using a resistance and dissipate the energy by using the Joule effect. Generally, this problem have to be solved by the battery manufacturer, because we have to buy not the cell but the battery system. But the quality of the solution that the producer have used can greatly influence the quality of the whole system. What are the solutions that you can find? The simple way to manage this problem is the passive cell balancing. It's very, very simple. You can put a resistor in parallel to each cell, and for example, if the energy or the voltage is the same, or this cell is greater than to this one, close this switch and destroy the energy. Destroy transformation, the energy in head on the resistor by using the Joule effect. This is a simple way. We have a low efficiency, but 19.9% of the application you will find this kind of solution. It's not new, it's well known, it works quite well. Then you can find in the presentation a lot of other solutions. Active switch at the capacitor, single switch at the capacitor, double triad capacitor, there are a lot of them. Right, just to give you an idea how the problem can be complex. But this one is the cheapest solution, so the right solution at this moment. Two solutions. Okay, just a couple of examples. In this part of the presentation, the focus is a lot on power electronics, so maybe I don't want to say just a little bit complicated, but it's a key point of the problem, so I try to I want to speak about this problem. And for each scheme that you can sketch, scheme that you can see, you can find also the reference, so you can download, if you want, the paper and study the paper, and if you have some question, you can write me an email and we can try to discuss. For example, this is an application where we have, first of all, we have to solve a problem. The problem is to fed a standard elevator by using monophase, just 3 kW in a classical Italian building. We have a power factor correction converter. Then we have a DC-DC interface too. In this case, we have used the supercap, but you can cancel the supercap and put in the same place also a battery. The power electronics does not change. By using this simple circuit, you can avoid to use a three-phase connection. If you have to use a three-phase connection, generally in a building of 4 floors, 5 floors, you need 10 kilowatt power, maximum power, and you will use that power just for a couple of seconds, just during the ramp up of the elevator. Instead, how it works? We can get energy from the network with the cosine phi, which is equal to 1. First of all, just a monophase connection, and use this storage system to store the energy during the deceleration of the elevators and to return back to the elevators the energy during the acceleration step. This is the control system, quite simple. Here you can see this is the current that we get from the network. This is the energy flow. During the acceleration of the elevator, you can see that we stop to get energy from the network to 3 kW. Despite this part of power is the one that we obtain from the supercap or from the battery system. This is the velocity. Where is the velocity? This one is the velocity. No, this is the torque. When we have the deceleration step, we store the energy in the supercap or in the battery system. So we have increased the efficiency of the elevator. From a theoretical point of view, we are just paying the mechanical losses of the elevator. From a theoretical point of view, of course. This works quite well. And this part of the scheme is a product that we have and we sell to the market. It's not just a research activity, right? It starts in 2007 as a research activity. Now it's a product you can buy if you want. We can obtain the same by using also a three-phase connection. This kind of bridge has the capability to get energy from the network the cosine phi, which is equal to 1. Of course, also in this point, you can have battery or supercaps, what you want. At the end, this is the full bridge. By using this bridge, you can have, in a smart grid, here, for example, 50 hertz, from this side, 70 hertz. Here you can have a voltage, here you can have another voltage, and you can control the energy that flows through the bridge. This kind of converter we call PWM rectifier or double-fed bridge. Practically, we are speaking about two classical inverters that works together. There are a lot of mathematical issues that you have to solve, but by using this kind of bridge, in this example, here I have a motor. It's not just an example, because if, for example, we are in the mining sector, and I want to build up a small smart grid in the mining sector, I have to manage the inrush current of the induction machine. I have a lot of induction machine. I cannot accept that the voltage drops down when I start the induction machine. So I have to put something that separates the induction machine from the grid, and maybe put in this point another storage system. Otherwise, the smart grid is not so smart. Okay, a couple of pictures about the project that we have made. These are the projects that we have made in Eritrea. We are speaking about 76 small smart grid, starting from two smallest is 5 kilowatts, if I well remember, the biggest is 300 kilowatts, for a total of 10 megawatt hour. We must use lead acid batteries, not a technical issue, but it's a contract matter, let me say. The contract that we sign says that we have to use that kind of battery and not different. Not lithium and so on. Don't ask me why, right? But that is the content. To be honest, in a very small one, we can use the lithium, and we are going to use NMCs for nickel, manganese, cobalt. But anyway, it's lithium battery. In Asmara. The problem of transportation, we must use lead acid battery. This means that the shelters are very, very big, even if the quantity of energy or the quantity of kilowatt hour that we are going to use are not so big. And this is an issue. Okay? This is an issue. This shelter is for 5 kilowatt hour. It's a truck for just 5 kilowatt hour. If with the same dimension, maybe we can have 200 kilowatt hour by using lithium, roughly. So the difference is amazing. And sometimes transportation is a very, very big issue, especially if you are speaking about rural application in remote areas, right, where you don't have the highway and so on, and in a lot of smart grid, we have to build the street because we don't have for that kind of truck. The technical solution that we used is this one. We have the PV, the DC-AC converter, in order to have the grid connection, because sometimes we have the grid connection, sometimes we don't have. But the scheme is practically the same, okay? Then we have, this is this DC-DC converter in order to charge or discharge the battery. Then we have also the diesel, this is the connection for the diesel. And practically this is a very small smart grid, because you have the connection to the grid, you have two different generator, diesel and PV, you have the storage system, and you have to arrange, to build up the control algorithm in order to manage as best you can the energy flow. Of course, the constraints are very, very simple. I don't want to use the diesel, I hope, right? I don't want to use the grid, and I want to maximize the use of the energy produced by the PV plant. This is another company, a sister company, which produces power electronics, and the company of the Enertronica Group. And I will show you another two different applications, quite old. This is an application for an industry, you know, 2009, I suppose, by using molten salt batteries. Sonic, okay, 2011, where we have used a lot of Sonic batteries, then these are the name of the product that we have used, and practically we fed an automatic warehouse. There is also the PV. Another application that we have made is in Iran. Also in this case, the connection is in an AC smart grid. Some picture of the power electronics. This is the control system, standard industrial PC. All the know-how is inside this PC, because this is we call it the battery management system. All the algorithm that I depicted in the slide, where we decide when use the energy from the battery, when use the energy from the grid, okay? All the know-how is inside to this PC. This is another application in Australia. This is quite different, because in this factory they will pay a lot of penalty if they use more power that they have declared and not have the right profile that they have to declare to the grid. So what happened? Okay. If this is the daily profile that they have declared, and they are going to absorb more energy, they have to pay. If they absorb less energy, they have to pay. Okay? Penalties. We have introduced a storage system in order to say, okay, with an error of 5%, 10%, let me say, we can assure that the lower profile is that one, not something of stochastic. Of course, it's possible to reduce the aleatority, the oscillation band, according to how many money you want to spend in terms of batteries. Okay, so you have to design the right dimension of the battery system according to the penalty, according to another engineering problem and evaluation problem. Okay.